Today is September 16th at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm at Fondren Library interviewing Yuriko Kajiya for the Houston Asian American Archive. My name is Priscilla Lee. So the first question is, where and when were you born?
I was born in Japan in 1984.
Okay. And can you describe your favorite childhood memory?
For me, all I can think of is when I was training in a ballet school.
Okay. And like, you liked practicing?
Not in the very beginning, but once I turned around age 13, I start become bunhead and really liked just being in a studio and practice.
Mm-hmm. Was that your childhood dream to be a ballerina?
No. A lot of people do ask me that just because I moved to China when I was 10 to go to ballet school. Mm-hmm. So most people think, oh, I must have really loved ballet that I had to go to China to be trained. But no. Ballet just happened to be one of the after school curriculum that I did. And my parents wanted me to have a little bit of a culture difference in the culture experience. Maybe stay there for 1 month, maybe 2 months, and then go back to Japan. But I ended up staying there for 6 years.
And was it because you wanted to stay there?
Yes, mm-hmm. But not because I loved ballet. No, not at that time. I really didn't understand it that much. But actually, my mom came and picked me up. I'm not sure how long after, maybe a month after. She came back because it's a national ballet school in China. It's government funded and it's very, very strict. And all the students there are handpicked by the government. Handpicked meaning like the ballet body, what we call the perfect ballet body. So for out of the thousands, they pick maybe 10 or 15 in one class and that's all they pick. And then it was all done by the government. But I'm from Japan and I'm not picked. You know, I went there because my parents paid the tuition, and I actually found out later that the school actually told my parents that you shouldn't send your child here because your child is too young and she doesn't have the body and she won't last because it's just very strict. But my parents told them that, you know, maybe stay for a month or two. I just want my daughter to get culture experience. So school agreed and I stayed. But after a month or two later, my mother came and said, you know, you don't have to, because she knew it was such a difficult situation for me, and the scheduling for the school is very difficult and very strict and nothing like when I was in Japan, and the environment wasn't as great. It's very different now in Shanghai and in China, but back in the day they didn't really have a lot of things. It was not the same as the living situation in Japan. So all of that together, my mother came and said, you know, basically said, honey, you don't have to work so hard anymore. You know, it's not like I said I wanted to stay, or I say I wanted to become a ballerina. So she said, let's go home. But even though at that time I didn't like ballet that much, I wasn't very into it, but even though I was only 10 years old and just a baby, but I just felt like I started some things. For me to go back at that time, only about a month or two later, just felt like a failure for myself. So I told them that I want to stay. Okay. So that's how it started, and stayed for 6 more years.
How would you describe China's ideal body type for ballerinas during that time?
Well, that's not only China, but okay, it's for overall ballet world. We in the perfect world, nobody has the perfect body, I don't think, but we all look for long legs and long arms, but not just that, but in ballet, all the joints has to be open, which is not normal for a lot of people. So if you have a joint, especially for the hip joint, to be a little bit in, that you have to do a lot of forcing, and that's a lot of pressure for the joints, and you're just going to suffer a lot more than the people who are naturally open. So they look at those things, the joints has to be open, the knee has to be small and straight, or even hyperextended, or nice arch. We like arched feet, and so there are a lot of different things, and I don't really have all of that. So the school, that's why the school say, your daughter doesn't have the body.
So your peers were older than you?
Some of them are my age, but most of them are maybe a year or two older than me in my class.
And for ballet school, did they also teach you like school, like academics?
Yes, so okay. Everything was in one, kind of like the Rice University, in one campus, in one school, they did everything in there.
Okay. And can you remind me the name of the school?
Shanghai Dance School. Okay. But I think the name might have changed now.
Okay.
But
And the year you moved over was?
1994.
Okay. And so how would you describe your 6 years there as training as a ballerina?
Looking back now, so hard, super strict, but can I do that going back right now? Probably not, but at that time, I never felt difficult or hard or, I don't know, I think because everyone else was doing it, like all my friends at that time were doing it all together, we were all in it together, so I never felt like, oh, why am I only one suffering? Mm-hmm. Even though I was there as a Japanese foreign student at age 10, but there were other, maybe not a lot, only like two or three other foreign students that are from Japan, and they were all in high school age, so a little bit, for 10 years old, quite a bit older, so they would be like 16, 17, 18, and they were all homesick. I think part of it was because they understand the life much better than I did. I was too young to understand what's difficult, so maybe that's why it worked out.
So you didn't experience much of a culture shock from Japan?
Yes, I did. But I didn't cry about it,
okay.
No.
Okay. And I saw that you can speak Mandarin.
Yes.
Did you learn Chinese before you went to
Japan? No, I learned when I was there. Mm-hmm. And I had a Chinese teacher who didn't speak any Japanese teaching me Chinese. So I remember when my first class was, she was trying to just gesture, this is how you say you in Chinese. But I didn't understand what she was trying to teach me. So a lot of, at that time we didn't have cell phones or all this technology. So we were looking at the dictionary and trying to search the word, and she would say, that's what I'm trying to teach you. And but I think because I was so young, I was able to pick up things so much quicker than the other older students.
Mm-hmm.
So in 3 months, I was able to understand what people were saying. Maybe not speak perfectly, but I was fine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did you have any mentors that you, or like close friends that you attribute, you know, to having like a better time, I guess, in school? Because it was very hard, like strict and stuff.
It was strict, but you know, we were all in it together, so all the friends, we were, we were all competing to each other, but at the same time, we are all friends together. And I'm actually still friends with all of them. And just now, 3 months ago, I was in China, and I actually met with some of them. And it was very fun to get together and talk about all the, laughed about all the memories.
Do you remember your first ballet class?
I do. I didn't understand a word the teacher was saying, but I just remembered because it was done by the government, and at that age group for dance, maybe in a smaller school or in United States or in Japan, you'll be doing a lot more dancing stuff. But in China, they were only doing super basic things, just trying to put that in the body. So I just remember everyone just being so flexible and only doing very easy things, but trying to perfect those things. So that was definitely a little bit different than what I was doing when I was in Japan. And but what I was doing in Japan in dance was not professional. It was just once a week thing. But they were doing it every day, and I just remember they're just so flexible, and I couldn't do any of it.
How many hours would you practice?
The hours of practicing gets longer as the age goes. Mm-hmm. So when we're a little bit younger, maybe a little bit less. But being in a studio, not like practicing, but like stretching and like, you know, all the things started like 6 or 6:30 in the morning. So.
And it lasts until like.
I do remember the bedtime. The lights all turn off at 9:15.
Oh, wow. Do you remember what you would do like for fun? Like after practice in school?
There was no fun time. No.
You didn't get to explore Shanghai?
No, well, we were not allowed to go outside of the school. I was only 10. I shouldn't be going out. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the students were only allowed to go out on the weekends, and people who are from Shanghai will go home, but for people who are not, they will stay in. But we do get to go out, but you know, I was so young, I wasn't going to go explore the city, only somewhere around the school. You know, didn't do the bus ride or any of that. But I don't know, for fun, it's like talking to my friends and maybe exchanging stickers. We didn't have cell phones, so yeah. No TVs. Mm-hmm. So reading books, but most of it just, you know, just being together with other students, my friends. Mm-hmm. But no, I definitely didn't have the same playtime or the childhood like that. Maybe the other, I don't know, the normal people would have, no, you know, but no, I never missed it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And so you said that you kept going because you didn't want to feel like a failure for like leaving after a month.
Mm-hmm.
Where would you say you got that, like, I don't know, personality or like drive to continue ballet?
Not sure.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I was always kind of that way, a little more motivated than maybe the other students even when I was in Japan. Not sure it was good or bad, but always trying to achieve the best as I can. Maybe looking back, maybe it was too competitive, I'm not sure, mm-hmm. as a child, but I mean, it worked out. But all of that definitely built me as who I am now, and all the hard work did pay off, so.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Did you face any discrimination because you were a foreigner in China?
Yes, many people has asked me, was there, you know, were you bullied because you're Japanese or all of that questions. I mean, yes and no. If I say yes in one word, that's wrong. If I say no, that's wrong too. But all my friends all protected me. They didn't think, oh, because I'm from Japan, so we're not gonna talk to her. There was none of that. But the biggest thing was because I'm a foreign student and the school was funded by the government, which everything makes sense because government's paying for this school and the government's paying for these students, so they have to produce someone that's very good out of this class because these are the students of their own. So the teachers also doing the same thing, which means in class, the teachers only watching the Chinese students. But even for them too, if let's say I had 15 classmates, she's really only like one or two. The other, even for the other Chinese students, the teacher will really only looking at the ones that she or he thinks will come out that will be the international level or that they think will be the best one. But that was just a natural thing for them to do. So as a child, for me, I wanted to be Chinese because I felt like, oh, maybe the teacher wasn't looking at me because I'm not Chinese. So at that time, I didn't like being Japanese, not because I was bullied, no, not because of that, but because I wanted them to look at me the same way as the other students. Mm-hmm. So that was maybe my struggle that I had there for sure. But I definitely had, I feel like I had more drive in the end than the other students because I wasn't picked. Maybe I didn't have the body. My parents are paying for the tuition, but the others are not. So they are not necessarily there because they wanted to be there. They're chosen, that's why they're there. But I made the decision to be there, so maybe I do feel like my drive was maybe more than the others in class.
And then when did you realize you wanted to pursue a career in ballet?
That was about when I was age 13. So it still did take 2-3 years in the school, just kind of wondering, even though it wasn't easy. But I think all started it because around the age 13, that's when my class started doing competitions. So which means you start doing things that are more dancing. Mm-hmm. So you have the music and you start doing like a solo role. So before it was more strictly steps in class. So a little more dance element came in. Mm-hmm. And I decided that I wanted to do the competition, and all of the practice towards the competition kind of got me into ballet, because as much all the hard work you put it in, because I was little, when the teacher says, oh, you got better, or you can feel that something is working, or the teacher will say, that's better, or that looks good, or, you know, all the praise as a child was so inspiring to me, because, you know, mm-hmm. Because usually they'll say, that's wrong, this is wrong, you need to fix this, you need to do all of that. But physically, I could feel like, oh, I practiced this, and then I can feel this is better, or now it's working. So the reward, I guess, you know, so the reward that you can feel was made me want to do more. So that made me want to practice more, made me stay in the studio even longer. So that really got me into more and more time in the studio. And that's when I became a bunhead. And I was in the studio all the time. And I liked it.
Did you, I guess the part of like expressing yourself is what you liked, versus, because in the beginning they only taught you mm-hmm. form and technique,
uh-huh.
but then you liked the expressiveness through dance and
yes.
music.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember your first performance or competition, I guess? Or?
My first competition was a national competition in China.
Okay.
So unlike here in the United States, anyone can do the competition, but there in China, because it's a national competition, you can only do if you're picked also within the school. So even get into the competition, you have to do a little competition inside the school of your classmates to get there. So I don't know, I just like the process of
And then, do you remember your first, I guess, repertoire that you, like, rehearsed and, like, memorized and performed for an audience?
The very first one was probably 11 in China, right? It was, like, a group piece. I think we were still on flat shoes, not on point shoes, the toe shoes. But that was just a group piece. But then when we did do the competition, I think I did something from Swan Lake. Mm-hmm. Not a swan, it's a human role, mm-hmm. but I can't remember the other one.
Something from Swan Lake.
Yeah.
Okay. And were your parents ever able to watch you perform?
Yeah, I mean, they came to China. But we didn't do, unlike the maybe like a school in the United States or in Japan, you know, the school has a once a year performance. Yeah. It wasn't, there was none of that. Mm-mm. So maybe I had, I mean, there are a few performances, but it's not an annual thing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they were supportive like for you like throughout your ballet training?
Mm-hmm. They never forced me to say, well, you started this, so you must become a ballerina. Mm-hmm. Or I don't know, they let me decide what I wanted, and I decided I wanted to do this, so they supported me till now, till the end. Okay. Yeah.
And so after, or how did you go, like what was your next step after, you know, studying in Shanghai?
So what happened was, my last year in school, I did a competition called Prix de Lausanne competition. It's one of the very prestigious competition in ballet world for young students. And it's in Lausanne, in Switzerland. Yeah. And it just happened to be that competition, they aired on national TV in Japan every year for the finals. So I grew up watching that, and so I really wanted to do that competition. So I actually told the school, and it happened to be the last year of my school year, so if everything worked out, I would do the competition and I could go somewhere else. The competition is not just gold, silver, bronze medal, it's about giving opportunity to the younger students. Mm-hmm. So if your age, youngest will be 15, if your age 15, 16, you get a full scholarship to any of the school of your choice around the world, and you get to go there. And if you're 17, 18, a little bit older, you get a scholarship to go to a company. So you'll become an apprentice for whichever company of your choice, which is amazing. But I was only 15, so I would have been going to another school. So that was always been dream of mine at that time. So I told my school in Shanghai that I want to participate in this competition. My direct answer first was no. They say you cannot go because they're planning to participate, and the rule for the competition that they had was you can only have 4 students participate at the same time. So if they wanted to bring 4 of their Chinese students, I would have been taking their spots, so I wouldn't be able to go. Mm-hmm. So they told me that you can go because we're going to bring 4 students. I was crushed. I really wanted to go, and I just thought it was not fair, and I really, really wanted to go. So I begged the school, and school decided to do a competition within the school and see whoever wins the top 4. We'll get to go, and I earned my spot, and that's how I got to go to the competition.
Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. And then, how did you do at the competition?
So I won the competition, and I actually got the highest points out of any of them in my school. So 4 of us went, and actually 3 of us won. So that was a big thing for the school. And definitely an eye-opener, just because opportunity just opened up. Mm-hmm. And obviously I realized I was good enough to win the competition and go somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So winning the competition definitely changed, really opened up my ballet world and opened up my future. And just because that time in China, we didn't have the computer, the internet situation wasn't there yet, didn't have a cell phone, no computer, so there was no outside information coming in. So I didn't know the other ballet world besides what I had in school. So even after winning the competition, you get to pick the school, but I didn't know the other schools. What are the difference, you know, what is the best? The only thing I knew were the few of them that you always hear the names of. But what are the difference? What would be the best fit for me? So the competition kept asking me, so have you decided? But I actually couldn't decide. So I actually did the opposite. I asked the competition, where do you think will be the best fit for me? And they told me that maybe I should go to National Ballet School in Canada. So that's how I chose the National Ballet School in Toronto, in Canada. And that's how I went from, so after I graduated from Shanghai Dance School, that's where I went.
Okay. And what year was that?
The competition was 2000.
Okay.
Competition was January, February 2000, and I graduated June or July, mm-hmm. I think. Yeah. And the school starts in September, I think.
Okay. The Canadian Ballets?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you were like 16?
I was just, when I won the competition, I was 15, and I just turned 16 when I went to Canada. Mm-hmm.
And did you ever get nervous at the competition, at the national or the international?
The competition? Mm-hmm. Yes and no. Mm-hmm. So unlike the other ballet competition, usually, normally when you do a ballet competition, you just do solos. Mm-hmm. You practice this one solo forever, and then you bring it to the competition, and then just that one chance that you do it, 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minute variation, and then you get judged. But what's different about this competition is they're trying to give opportunity to see the future for these young students. So you start from class, so they're watching you from the very beginning to do the entire class, and you get judged by that, and then they see you do solo and so on. So the first round is only class. You don't even get to do the solos that you practiced. So we do this thing called bar. You're holding onto the bar and you do like a basic practice, and you're judging you by them. So that part, because the competition has just started, I wasn't sure why I belong in the competition. So that was the only part that I wasn't sure. So am I gonna be able to get through the second round? But once I got through the first round, I was never nervous. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I just felt like I started enjoying the competition.
Okay. And so when you moved to Canada, how was that, you know, difference in culture like?
So different. Super different. Well, Canada was more like Japan now. So when I first went to China, it's completely different now. Shanghai is like New York. Mm-hmm. You have everything. The sky rises are just insane. Mm-hmm. But when I first went there, there was nothing. Maybe there was one tall building, but everything else is flat. It was before the Shanghai became the Shanghai now. So even for the school, I was staying in the dorm. The girls' dorm was on the fourth floor. The water doesn't even come up to the fourth floor.
Oh, and
just, so as a 10-year-old, carrying a bucket of water, mm-hmm. to the fourth floor so you can brush your teeth and, you know, wash your face. So that was what was happening for the next year. That was just, you know, maybe no water to flush the toilet. And, you know, that was just normal. I never thought twice. Mm-hmm. But when I got to Canada, you have everything. You have a air conditioning, which I didn't have, and you know, the studios are beautiful, and it was a completely different environment and not as strict. So one of the reasons why I did find out later that the fact that Prix de Lausanne competition told me to go to this particular school in Canada was because the school was not trying, the motto for the school was trying not to give the students so much pressure, so which was completely different than when I was in China. Not that they were just pressuring us, but it was just a lot more strict and a lot more practice time. So I did feel like when I first went to Canada, I was panicked a little bit, not because the language or anything like that, just because I feel like, oh, but I want to be in the studio more, I want to practice more, but they won't let you. They'll lock the studio so you can't go in. So that was just so different for me. So that part was definitely a culture shock.
And how long were you at that school?
I was only there for a year. So I got a scholarship for 1 year to go to the school from the competition. And then when I was in the school, I auditioned for the companies and I got into the company. So I only stayed in the school for 1 year.
Okay. And how would you describe their approach to teaching and training ballerinas compared to when you were in China?
It's just so different, huh? But I do feel like because I had that 1 year in Canada, if I would have gone to, so after Canada, I went to New York. But if I have gone from straight from what I had in China to New York, I think I might have been just completely lost to go to a company or big cities, or I know just the environment was so different. But because I was still in a school, even though the environment is so different in China, but I was still protected by the school and the teachers that had the support. Because if you go straight to a company, you're alone because you're not a student anymore. Mm-hmm. You're one individual. So that definitely gave me preparation to go to a company where I would have gone to go in New York. So that preparation 1 year in Canada was very big for me, and I met some great teachers that are still in touch, and then they're a teacher for 1 year, but they're also a great friend of mine, and some of the classmates there I still talk to, and so those connection means a lot to me. And I know it's a great school, just different.
And so the teachers that you met were very supportive of you throughout everything?
Yes.
Okay. And then was it natural, just to stay there a year? Could you have chosen to stay in school longer?
I could have, yes, okay. Because I was... So the National Ballet School in Canada is also like in China, that the academic school is built into the school. So I would have gone in because of my age. I was grade 11, so I would have another year in the school, but I actually did all of that when I was in China. So it all worked out, but I could have stayed for another year, yes.
What made you decide to apply to be part of a company?
So it gets a little bit complicated, but the school year I was grade 11, so I would have one more year.
Yeah.
But my ballet class, I was with the top level.
Oh.
So my ballet classmates were all grade 12, so they were the graduating year school students. So I was with them even though I was a year younger. So they were all auditioning because they're about to graduate. So that's why I went audition.
Oh, okay.
It was just a natural thing for me.
And then how was auditioning, like, that process like?
Scary a little bit, I guess. But I mean, scary looking back now. Didn't feel that when I was... I guess I had a lot of more gut when I was younger. As you get older, everything you think more, so you get more cautious. But when you're younger, you go with your drive. So I didn't feel scared. But I auditioned for two companies, and I got... Actually, with American Ballet Theatre, I didn't get the job right away. So I was devastated because that's where I wanted to go. But so I was planning to stay for another year in the school, possibly, but that's when the company, ABT, American Ballet Theatre, called, said, we want to give you a contract. It was just, the reply was much, much later than we expected, so I thought I didn't get a job.
Okay, mm-hmm. Did you surprise super late? Okay. And then, how old were you when you started working with the company?
17.
17. Were you one of the younger?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So did you, face any, age differences? And was it hard to talk to people of older age at the company?
I think it's just like any other job, you know, mm-hmm. you have the younger ones and everyone's different age. That's just, I don't think there is any company in the world, not just ballet, but for normal work, yeah. you know, that has same age, mm-hmm. everyone's the same age, you okay. know, so, but obviously because I'm the youngest, and which means it's the, doesn't have any experience than others, so you just have to watch and learn that. But I had other friends that are same age, so I didn't feel like I was alone.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But I didn't join the main company right away. Mm-hmm. The company has a junior group called, at that time was called Studio Company. That was for people who were age 17 to maybe 20.
Okay.
So there were 6 boys and 6 girls. And then from there, some would join the company and some don't.
Mm-hmm.
So normally you can only stay in the junior company for 2 years, the maximum. And then you have to either join, if you don't get to join, maybe you have to go somewhere else.
Okay.
But I was there for quite short. I was there for 3 months.
Oh, wow.
Yes. And then I joined the main company. So all my other friends stayed in the junior company for another year. But most of them joined later, so we were still together.
Mm-hmm. And that's mm-hmm. based on your performance, being able to join?
Obviously, at that time, you would like to think that because of your performance, mm-hmm. but now you do learn that, you know, joining a company, by a company, a lot has to do with, yes, you have to have, obviously, you have to be good,
mm-hmm.
technically, physically, performing-wise, all of it together, but also timing has to be right.
Mm-hmm.
If nobody leaves the company doesn't have a spot.
Okay.
And sometimes they're looking for certain looks,
mm-hmm.
looks meaning not necessarily have to be Asian or American, not like that, but height.
Mm-hmm.
If someone very tall leaves, they might want to replace someone around that height or short or medium range, you know, so it has a lot of different things happens.
Mm-hmm.
But
how was it like going to New York City from Canada, like all these cultural differences?
I do remember going there first as an audition.
Mm-hmm.
So I went there for audition with 2 of my other friends from Canada. My first impression for New York was so scary.
Mm-hmm.
I was able to speak English then, but New Yorkers just speak so differently. They speak so fast. And everything just moves so fast. Everyone's just in their own zone and just the street, and it's just so much going on. I was just lost.
Mm-hmm.
So even though I was there for a few days to do the audition, I just felt like this is crazy city. But that was only when I auditioned. After that, after I moved there, I loved New York, and
okay.
that was my home.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
What do you like about New York?
Hard to pinpoint one thing, because
yeah.
that became my home for so long.
Mm-hmm. How about food-wise? Did you ever seek Chinese or Japanese food?
You can get pretty much everything
mm-hmm.
there in New York, and I think one of the biggest thing I like about New York is because all my friends were there.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So they were like my family, so that naturally I wanted to stay there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. And what are the demographics of the American Ballet Theatre, where most other ballerinas, like Asian or Caucasian?
American Ballet Theatre is very international.
Okay.
When I was there, we had Cubans, obviously Americans, Argentinian, Spanish, Italian, French, and then for the Asian cultures, we had Japan, Korea, Thailand, China. Filipinos. So it's New York, the city itself,
yeah,
is so international.
Mm-hmm.
So naturally the company is very international, and you don't feel like, oh, just because I'm Asian. No, I didn't ever felt that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so your first job was in the studio?
Studio company.
Studio,
mm-hmm.
Company. Okay.
And
you
then
paid for it?
Somewhat. Not a whole lot.
Okay.
Not that you can be living in New York City,
okay.
No.
Okay.
So that was actually one of the biggest concerns that my parents had in the beginning. My parents are not a multi-millionaire, so they were views, the cultures, and the price difference in living situation in New York was so expensive.
Yeah.
So if that would go on for a long time, we just felt like I wouldn't be able to live there. But luckily, because I was moved up to the main company only in 3 months,
mm-hmm.
So once I got into the company, I was paid.
Okay.
Like a normal,
mm-hmm.
and the insurance and all of that, so the situation changed.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
And then can you kind of briefly explain the ranks and positions of ballerina, or the positions that you acquired throughout your career,
mm-hmm.
at American Ballet Theatre?
So every company, the ranking is different.
Okay.
So some company has more ranking than the others. Right now, where I am, Houston Ballet has more ranking than American Ballet Theatre does. But in the big picture, we all do the same things. We all use the same words, which is quarter ballet, which means the group dance, solo dancers that does solos, and then the principal dancers that carries the entire ballet in the center. So in the big words, would be quarter ballet, solos, and then principals. But within that, you can break it a little more,
mm-hmm.
to give more opportunities. So American Ballet Theatre, we only had quarter ballet, soloist, principal. So it's a big jump going,
yeah.
from the quarter ballet to soloist, soloist, the principal. In Houston Ballet, where I am now, we have quarter ballet, demi soloist, soloist, first soloist, principal.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. And then, how long were you at American Ballet Theatre, and then what was the transition like to go from that company to Houston Ballet?
So I was with American Ballet Theatre for, I always have to rethink,
mm-hmm.
15 years.
Okay.
And that was a long time. And to be honest, I never thought I would come to Houston, just like I never thought I would go to New York, or never thought I would,
yeah.
become a ballerina. But just at the time, where American Ballet Theatre was not, I didn't like the direction the company was going.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like I had to leave to become a better dancer. So I started looking for different places, then that's where I chose to come to Houston.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And when was that year that you came to Houston?
2014.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And what were your first impressions of Houston?
So I have come to Houston before.
Okay.
So it wasn't my first time. I actually came to Houston to do a few Nutcracker guesting.
Mm-hmm.
So we call it guesting, meaning you're not traveling with your company, but individually you go,
mm-hmm.
dance with some school or the company, so,
mm-hmm.
that's what we call guesting. But I have come to Houston for Nutcracker performances as a guest. So I've been here probably 5 or 6 times before I moved here. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what you first thought of Houston? Like weather or just the people?
I just remember after I moved here, everyone, literally everyone across the board says, are you ready for the Houston weather? Everyone says, are you ready for this hot weather? But my answer was always, well, you're always in the car and you're always inside.
Yeah.
So I never actually felt, I mean, yes, when you go out, sometimes you're like, woo, the heat, but you don't really walk outside as much because in New York, you have to walk everywhere.
Yeah.
So you actually feel the heat more. Mm-hmm. So I was always like, oh, what are you guys talking about?
So it wasn't, you're okay with the weather?
No, no. I mean, just like now, it's always inside, so I never always felt the heat. But I was actually shocked with how much the, how great the Asian food scene is here. There's a great Chinatown that has everything.
Yeah.
Which I was shocked with all these supermarkets that you can practically get anything you want from all these different Asian countries. So that way I have everything that I need to.
Do you find yourself cooking more, or if you do cook at home, do you cook more Asian cuisine?
I think I only cook Asian
cuisine.
Yeah.
Okay. Is it a mix of like the Chinese? Or
mix of Chinese, Japanese, and sometimes Korean.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Let's see. Oh, what was your position when you came to Houston Ballet?
For Houston Ballet?
Mm-hmm.
I was a first soloist.
First soloist.
And then two months later, I became a principal.
Oh, okay, wow.
Mm-hmm.
And then can you tell us about your first performance, like with the Houston Ballet, as principal?
As a principal, what did I perform? Well, I was promoted. What's great about or tradition the Houston Ballet has is when someone become a principal, they announce on stage, which at ABT we didn't do that. We were told in the studio in front of all of our colleagues. But here, the artistic director, Stanton Walsh, comes on stage and announces this is a very special performance because you're just about to witness this so-and-so become a principal, or so-and-so is announced a principal. So you become principal on stage after a performance. So that performance was Nutcracker.
So you were debuting as principal, so to speak?
So would that performance count as a principal? I'm not sure. But that's definitely a special moment for a lot of us who became a principal, because you become one on stage and you share that moment with the audience and the friends and dancers on stage.
Mm-hmm. You said you wanted to come to Houston Ballet to grow as a dancer.
Mm-hmm.
Do you still have coaches who help you, or just the environment helps you become a better dancer?
Well, the reason why, so there were other offers that I could go to,
mm-hmm.
not all in the States, actually all in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And they had offered me the positions, and I have been there, and I took classes with them. And some places, you take class, and you can already feel that maybe it doesn't fit. It's not your, you don't feel comfortable. Or all the artistic directors, they're all so nice that they always say, I want you to come because I want you to make sure that you like the company and you like the city, because
mm-hmm.
you're going to have to live in the city. So some cities that maybe I just felt like, I don't know if I can imagine myself living here, or, you know, so things like that. But with Houston Ballet, the biggest draw was maybe the repertoire. They're ballets that they do was very interesting, and there were a lot of ballets that wanted to dance. So by talking to the director, Stanton Walsh. Stanton and I actually has a unique history. My first day at American Ballet Theatre in studio company, he was there. Mm-hmm. I was a baby, and he was also a young choreographer then. Mm-hmm. So he was actually choreographing for a studio company where I was. So that was my first day at ABT. So it kind of, in a way, made a full circle. So I was talking to him on the phone, and he felt like it would be a good fit for me. And I liked where the company was going with the repertoire. So that's one of the reasons why I chose Houston Ballet. So not because of one thing, it was a big picture. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Have you ever had any injuries that stopped you? How do you keep yourself from getting hurt while training?
Well, unfortunately, you always try not to get injured, but you do get injured. What we do as a ballet dancer is very different. Not an easy thing for the body, because nothing is natural. So I say, if you ask any dancer, do you have injuries, everyone has, big or small, they all have some kind of injuries. Mm-hmm. So to prevent injuries, you always have to maintain yourself in certain level and certain condition, and also have to develop maintenance. But unfortunately, injury sometimes just happens. You can't prevent it sometimes. I do have a big injury. I call it the bomb. So because it's not like you can't, it's stopping me from dance right now. But if it does get worse, I would have to probably get a surgery. But I'm listening. You have to learn. You will learn how to listen to your body when you get injured, because you can't just go. You may be able to do that when you're really young, but your body does. Its body is an interesting thing. It will react to what you're doing. Yeah. So it won't last forever if you just bash into the wall every day. Yeah. So I have learned how to maintain my body with my injuries. So it's been okay.
Have you ever experienced any difficulties or dilemmas that made you question or even regret your career choice?
Sure, maybe one day or two, but it was never a thing that you just, I think all of us dancers, if you ask anyone, they would always say, it's a lot of hard work behind what we do, mm-hmm. but you can only do it because you love it. Mm-hmm. So that drive is definitely what's keeping us going forward. So you may have a down day that you may think for a second that, what am I doing? Or maybe you want to do something else, but most of us next day will just forget about what you were thinking because we love what we do.
Okay, awesome. And what are your most memorable accomplishments so far?
So many things that I'm proud of and feel like I have achieved, but obviously it's never just one goal. You can always keep going, especially with art form. Unlike the math, you do this and then there's the answer and that's it. Mm-hmm. For us, we don't have an answer. You can change the answer and everyone will judge you differently. And there's no limit of how much you can give and how much you can get better and how much you can do. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the reasons why it's interesting and everyone reacts differently. So, I don't know, it's hard to pinpoint one.
Yeah. For sure, but that makes a lot of sense that you never have an end goal.
And especially for us, all the performers, opera singers, same thing. We don't just do one role and then that's it, and then you move on to next. That role will probably come back. Because we keep constantly doing a lot of the big classics, and that's one of the reasons why it's a great ballet. That's why it's been going on for hundreds and hundreds of years. Mm-hmm. So that's great for us because we mature as a person and mature as a dancer. So how I did at age 20, in the same role to 25, to 30, to 35, each time it comes back, it gives something different. Mm-hmm. And discover different things, and I don't know, it's very interesting and very fun.
So, let's see. How do you manage work-life balance?
Everyone's different, but it's hard for me to just completely shut down just because I move out of the Houston Ballet or the studio or the theater, that I just become normal. No, I think constantly in the summer that I'm always thinking about dance, and even on a day off, we're constantly doing something towards ballet, meaning like maybe it's a, say I'm getting a massage, but it's not a massage just to relax, it's a massage to maintain your body. So for us, massage is quite painful. Yes, it's not a fall asleep kind of massage, because my arm muscles are so tight that it has to do maintenance for us to continue for the next week or the next performance. Or you're seeing athletic trainer or physical therapist, or you're getting acupuncture, or you're doing Pilates, or you're doing gym work, or you're doing so many different things. Mm-hmm. So everything somehow it's always towards what I do.
Do you ever go overseas to perform or to like coach or anything?
Yes. So performance wise, I do my personal guesting. So sometimes I do guest outside the country. Mm-hmm. And also when the company travels, even though Houston Ballet is based in Houston or American Ballet Theatre based in New York, we had a lot of tours. So I did do more tours with American Ballet Theatre just because ABT is a touring company. And Houston Ballet is a Houston-based company. So, but like with Houston Ballet, last year we were in Dubai.
How has ballet training and living abroad affected like family back in Japan, or like friends you've made along the way?
I feel like being outside the country, it made me realize how great, how much I appreciate my own background is. Mm-hmm. Me being Japanese, I didn't realize how great a country Japan was, and being Asian, I appreciate the Asian culture compared to maybe over here, or the what's great about Asian culture. So it made me realize all these things that I would have not realized maybe if I lived in, if I never left Japan, or if I was only in Asia. And family bond definitely got stronger by leaving. I mean, I left when I was 10, so made me appreciate things so much sooner than the other people maybe.
And how would you identify yourself as? Japanese-American,
or how would you identify? I'm from Japan, but I have spent more than half of my life now in here in the States. So it's very interesting because when I'm here in the States, people say, oh, Yuriko, you're so Japanese. But then if I'm in Japan, people say, you're so American. So, so I'm very hybrid, I guess.
Yeah. Oh, and have you interacted with the Japanese community here?
Yes, and in Houston, I actually have quite a few Japanese dancers, mm-hmm. and not just Japanese, but there are Chinese two Chinese dancers, and now two Korean dancers. Mm-hmm. So there are quite a big number as compared to other companies, I think, I feel. There are big number for Asian dancers in the company, so I'm proud to be one of them, and I'm one of the older ones in the company, so I'm proud to be their big sisters and take care of them.
And you mean, like, do you mentor them? Do you support them?
Mm-hmm, yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. I do love mentoring younger generation. That's one of my other passion. Mm-hmm. Even though I am a ballerina, I'm still dancing on stage, mm-hmm. but I do feel like one of the things that you are supposed to do as a ballerina is to mentor the younger generation, because I was mentored as a young ballerina to someone who are older, or my coach who used to be one of the biggest ballerina in Russia, and she was giving me all the information that she could give, and with unconditional love. So I would like to do the same to the next generation.
Mm-hmm. And then has your drive towards ballerina and ballet and the dance profession, has it changed since when you were young at, in the Shanghai school?
The drive, the love towards ballet has always been there, but I think your way of thinking is always constantly changing, just because I'm maturing as a person and as a dancer. So maybe when you're younger, you're more, that's just a nature of it, actually. When you're a young dancer, you're a little more focused on maybe just the form of dance or the steps or just the technique, which means for us it's more like how many turns can you do? How high can you jump? So more, a lot more technical elements. But we are art form, and I believe at the theater, people are not here to come see us do the turns and jumps. You can see that on YouTube on the phone. Mm-hmm. But the reason why we call it we are artists, we are not sports. We are theater. It's a part of the art form. It's because we have performing aspect, mm-hmm. and if we can move someone who's watching the performance, mm-hmm. then I feel like I have failed as a dancer on stage. So that kind of way of thinking is definitely changing. So that's also same way for approaching the role or the piece that I'll be dancing, or the way I practice towards a part is definitely different than how maybe I would prepare when I was younger.
What do you think is important to create a successful performance? I know you said connecting with the audience.
Connecting with the audience, to bring the audience to our world on stage. I call it sometimes a catch ball, like when you do playing the ball game, when you throw something, you have to have someone throw it back. You can't constantly just throw it towards them and nothing comes back. So it's the same thing on stage, you want to invite the audience to what we do on stage, so we become one. So sometimes we call it when the magic happens. So that's when you can feel the whole theater becomes one, mm-hmm. and that's a very magical moment. And also, if you're doing a story ballet, most ballets you have men and women, there's the most ballet has a romantic love story, either it's a tragic love story or there is a happy ending. But when the chemistry happens between your dancers, that's always a great moment also.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any like advice for aspiring ballet artists?
You have to love, not just for ballet, but for any profession. If you don't love it, I don't think you can make it. Not any, maybe some can be forced and become successful, but I don't think any profession, if you're becoming a professional at something, there's so much hard work behind it. Nothing comes easy. So if you don't have the love and the drive, you can make it.
And I guess overall, like, how was your experience moving around to so many different countries? Mm-hmm. How do you think that has changed you or helped you grow?
Moving to different places always happy and sad at the same time, because you have to say goodbye to your friends that you met, but you get to meet a new friends in different city. So I love the getting connection with different people. Mm-hmm. So that's making me a better person.
You've been able to go back to Japan?
Yes.
And how has, I guess, Japan received you as, you know, gaining recognition as a ballerina in different countries? How has Japan received you as a ballerina?
They have been very supportive, I think. Mm-hmm. But my ballet background also came from China. Mm-hmm. So I'm also talking to, actually right now, as of now, I'm talking to the Chinese ballet side too, so maybe I will be able to go back and give back what I have learned to the Chinese school. Mm-hmm. So I feel fortunate that I, even though my passport might be Japanese, but I can represent so many different countries. Mm-hmm. I can represent Japan and the Chinese ballet, and then I do represent America also. So it's been very great.
Do you feel like your, I guess, ballet style is a mix of all three, or it changes based on what you're performing and where you're performing?
It's definitely a mix of a lot. Mm-hmm. but you have to constantly get better and learn new things. So I don't know if I still have what I learned the first day from Chinese school or the Japanese school, because then I'm going backwards. So I'm constantly trying to learn something new. So I don't know what I am now, but I think I'm my own way, I guess.
And that kind of concludes the interview today.
Okay.
Is there anything you would like to add about, is there anything that you'd like to add in the
history? No, I think we got quite a lot.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for
your time. No, thank you.